Zsolfen is senior lecturer in humanitarian and development studies. He is an expert in political economy, and particularly within the region of Southeast Asia and Indonesia. Today he's going to talk to you about minimum wage and unemployment benefit and how this articulates with human rights. So please give Zsolfen a very warm welcome.
Thank you, Nicole, for a very kind introduction. Okay, I'm here to talk specifically about the economic aspects of human rights. Probably because I'm the only economist within the group, so that's why Debra asked me to talk something related to the economic side of the human rights discussion. To make life a bit more easier, rather than introducing you to the abstract, high-end concepts, I think it would be better to start the discussions with the two real issues. Something that, unfortunately, this is my casual observations. I could be wrong, so you have to correct me if I'm wrong. Unfortunately, my limited observation in Australia, people in Australia just take for granted to receive unemployment benefit and to enjoy the minimum wage. Now we are going to see those two main features of the economic and social life in Australia from the perspective of human rights. To understand that one, you need to see where is the entry point of those two kinds of privilege in the broader discussion of human rights? And secondly, to understand the origins of those two kinds of policies, unemployment benefits and minimum wage. So, but the bottom line is, all of us here in Australia enjoy those two things. You are protected. Cannot be paid less than the minimum wage by law, but of course there are cases where the law is not fully implemented. Or if you are out of job for whatever reason, you will be protected by the welfare payment in the form of unemployment benefit. So unemployment benefit is not the only welfare payment available in Australia, but one of the main ones. So that's the idea of this lecture. So that's why we start with a little bit cynical title, don't take it for granted. And the next title is about minimum wage and unemployment benefits from the perspective of human rights. I think I've summarized what you are going to hear in the lecture. I've summarized it well, so if you want to leave now, you have the summary of the lecture. Okay, roughly speaking, this is the agenda of our lecture today. The first one is very basic understanding, what? We'll discuss what it is. What is minimum wage? What is unemployment benefit? And what is human rights? And after that, we link minimum wage and unemployment benefit to the human rights. We try to link the three variables. And then we move a little bit forward to link the policies of minimum wage and unemployment benefits with the development progress. How we can see that one as the outcome of development progress. How they are related with the progress of development in, say, Australian society, for example. And you can easily see that in other countries who haven't reached the level of socio-economic and political development as advanced as Australia, you will see that they have no privilege to enjoy those two things. That here in Australia, we just take it for granted. Now the idea is, you will be more grateful at the end of the day, at the end of the lecture, sorry. Yeah? Because you realize that those two things are the outcome of long struggle. And then, the last part of the lecture will be about a reflective part. you should be able to evaluate where Australia stands relative to other countries in the world. Yeah. Let's start with the first one. Feel free to interrupt me when I'm explaining things. Yeah. Feel free to interrupt to have a kind of interaction, since we have a very small class, so it shouldn't be a problem. This would be a bit more difficult if you have 500 students in front. You have to be kind of one-way communications. Now, feel free to interrupt. Okay, let's start with the three things: minimum wage, unemployment benefit, and human rights. We start with the first one. Have you faced, have you received wage at the level of minimum wage? Have you had this kind of experience in your life? Doing casual work, working in McDonald's, doing casual cleaning jobs, whatever, something that can be easily done by the student without any skills. Have you come across experience of, or have you had experience being paid less than the minimum wage, for example, cash in hand? So you mean, okay, look, Nicole has the experience. So your experience being paid less than the minimum wage, or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cash in hand.
Cash in hand?
Yeah. So I wouldn't be taxed.
Ah, okay, but tax-free. Okay, plus and minus.
Yeah.
If you do the cherry picking,
right.
If you were in South Australia during the holiday season, a lot of students in South Australia, my fellow graduate student, they told me that we spend our summer holiday not coming back to the home country, but spending 2 months or 6 weeks working in the farm, enjoying $12, $10, whatever, or $15 if you're lucky.
Yeah.
Okay? No tax, no, this is informal economy, by the way. Everyone likes this one. The employer would like to do this one, and the student like to do that. So, I don't know. So the scale of the informal economy probably underestimated in this country. So there's a minimum wage, okay? So what is the formal definition? This is formal definition. By the name, you know the meaning. The lowest remunerations that employers may legally pay to workers. Legal. But not everything is legal in this country, or everywhere in the world. Yeah? Not everything is legal. But the question is, why that kind of legal aspect should be imposed? If you believe in the free market, this is against the free market. Yeah? If you are the follower of free market principle, this is in contrast to the free market. Yeah? What's wrong? If you are a student, you are looking hardly for jobs, and then someone offers you $15 an hour, and you do the cherry harvest or apple harvest in my farm. So what's wrong? You are happy to be employed. I'm happy to pay you. There is no coercion, yeah, no force, no nothing. So what's wrong with that? Yeah, why I have to be legally bound to follow the minimum wage? Why the government will have to bother themselves to set that law?
Don't you have the kind of questions, by the way? So they can get a tax or something? Government can take a tax?
Of course, that could be one explanation. Because it is out of the official recording, so this is beyond the reach of the tax mechanism. That's fine. But assuming that this is legal, say for example, just here, not farm is too far. Let's say I have a pizza shop. I need to employ 4 students like you, for example, to clean the shops, to serve the customers, for example. So I need just 4 youngsters to work in my pizza shop. I have the chef, everything, but I need 4 casual employees. So I have all the admin aspect of my small business in place. You are happy to be paid for $15. I'm happy to pay you $15. So what's wrong with that? Nothing wrong, right? For $12, nothing wrong, right? So, but the question is why? On the legal aspect, I'm not allowed to pay you for $12 or $15.
I mean, it's good though. I mean, you earlier you asked why is that when we talk about free market? Yeah, it's free market, but not free in the sense where there's no boundaries. Free within certain limits.
Yeah.
That's why the state come in, you know, to make sure that these limits are implemented.
So what is the idea of setting the limit? Why?
So they have control over you, in a way. So
who is me? Who are being protected by the minimum wage? Me as the employer or yourself as the workers? Who are being protected or being defended or being...
The workers.
The workers. So it means that if I am the employer, I don't like the minimum wage.
Yeah.
If you are the workers, you like the idea of minimum wage. When you change your position from the workers to employer, you upgrade yourself. Before you receive wage, now you have your own business. Initially you like minimum wage, and after you change your status to be to have the owner of the business rather than the employer of other businesses, initially you like minimum wage, and after that you hate the one. Mm. See? So there is no here better, good and bad. Depends on where you see the problem. We'll discuss this one later. So this is the way to see things more critically, not to take it for granted. Yeah. Okay, that's minimum wage. So we have here the proponent and the opponent. If you are the workers, if you don't want to be to have a very low bargaining power against your employer, and you like the idea of minimum wage. But if you are the one who have big factory, you are the capital owner, you are the business owner, you don't like the minimum wage. You want to get away of that kind of implementing that policy. And there are different reasons to agree on that one or to reject the idea of minimum wage. Okay, to be a bit more academic, of course, if you are on different side of the equations, you can be easily the opponent and you can be easily the proponent. But from the perspective of more academic, what kind of reason for rejecting the minimum wage? A little bit more academic, more conceptual reason for rejecting for the opponent of the minimum. Do you have any idea?
What sort of visa is it? What kind of equation is?
Now, we have the proponent and the opponent of the minimum wage policy. What is the conceptual reason for the opponent of the minimum wage, if you can see? Is there any idea? Is a policy. There are supporters and there are people like the policy. They support the policy. But there are also groups in the society who dislike that kind of policy. So we have proponent and opponent of that policy. So can you think of what kind of arguments that can be put forward by the opponent of that? The one who reject the idea of having a minimum wage also.
I mean, one of the things, I don't know if that's academic, but one of the reasons...
You can have the academic reason to reject the minimum wage policy.
Okay, but yeah. I don't know if that's only it's for that. One of the reasons could be that the opponent will feel like the minimum wage is implemented regardless of how much money they're making. So therefore, you have to pay people regardless, you know, how much you're making. But if there's no any idea of minimum wage, then therefore you could pay people according to how much actually you are making. So if you open a business, you know, you have to, and you have to go by legal system, then paying people within the minimum wage, then, you know, you have to struggle to kind of make money enough to be able to pay people.
Yeah. So, one of the argument is, minimum wage is not good for the businesses, for the expansions of the businesses. Minimum wage is against the market principle. You are destroying, you are disturbing the market principle. And according to this belief, market knows everything. So just let the market decide. If the market decides the wage level per hour is only $15, so let. And then, if the economy grow, okay, and there will be shortage of workers, and then eventually the wage level will go up. So let everything go to the nature. That's the idea of the, so the proponent of the free market will not like the idea of minimum wage. That's one of very strong academic reason to reject the idea of minimum wage. But the most important one is why you have to put that kind of policy? Why you have to set the minimum level? You don't set the maximum level. You can pay your manager, your CEO as much as you like, as much as the bargain. If you think that your CEO is worth paying for $1 million a year, you can pay. There's no roof, there's no limit for the roof. But why you have to set the minimum one? What is the basic idea here?
There's no way.
So both of you, you work at the level of minimum wage, will be right.
And couple women, non-national kids as well, children.
No kids. For people with kids, they will have a higher level of poverty line. So it means that if you have two kids and both of you work full time at the level of minimum wage, life will be very different. Yeah? So you have to have a different kind of calculations, whether you can avoid the status of being poor with two kids. So but this is just for simple explanations. For the couple, this is the poverty line, and that is the income for working full time at the level of minimum wage. But don't forget, this is the minimum wage. Of course you don't, you don't use that one as a standard. This is just the bottom line. This is the lowest place where you can fall, not below that one. Of course you don't target to be at that level. Okay? Okay. Let's have a bit more discussions about the minimum wage. You need to understand that this country was the pioneer of the minimum wage. Not the US, not the UK. Okay? Australia was the pioneer of the minimum wage. Worldwide. One of the pioneers. Not the first one, but one of the pioneers. Somehow, you know, the youngsters in Australia, they keep complaining about the country. They don't have the perspective how good is the country compared to other countries in the world. They think that the US is better than Australia, the UK is better than Australia, but if you look at different kind of perspective, you will value this country better. So hopefully this lecture will help you to have that kind of perspective. So Australia was the pioneer of the minimum wage policy.
The minimum wage in the United States is about $7 per hour. That's why they have tipping.
See, the tipping culture in the US was the outcome of low wage. They beg you, if you are in the US, they beg you, please give us a tip, because that tip will make us alive. Wage will not make them alive. We'll be dead just relying on the official wage. Yeah? And we don't have that kind of policy in the US. Yeah? So US is good if you are the rich, if you are just So
from what you said, in the US, they have a big problem of human rights issues.
Yeah, I've seen that. Though.
Probably. So, Australia was the pioneer of the minimum wage policy. Let me tell you a little bit more detail. Not in Australia as a federation, but from the United States. So Victoria introduced legal minimum wage even before the foundations of Australia. So from that perspective, you can see that Victoria is a bit more progressive than New Zealand. Yeah, look at this one. See? So that's why I can see now the competitions between Victoria and New South Wales, after all, between Sydney and Melbourne. And then after that one, New Zealand introduced the minimum wage in 1894. Then followed by the UK, and can you see how many decades after the US introduced the policy of minimum wage? Of course, this is not universal, but the introductions of the minimum wage policy. And you know that when the policy was first to be introduced, you know that the level of compliance would be very low. Yeah. But let's look at the starting point of the introductions of minimum wage policy. Now, you can see that how progressive was Australia. And to be a bit more, to give you a little bit more information. So this is the, how can we call it? The early definitions of minimum wage. Yeah? A living wage sufficient to meet the variety of needs of a person living in a civilized community. So this is the tone of the rights. So the proponent of minimum wage policy is based on the humanity principle, less on the economic principle. Then you can find the economic justifications of having that kind of policy. I'll show you later how the economic argument can also defend, can be also used as the supporter for to support the minimum wage policy. And then we know that minimum wage policy then gradually adopted by most other countries. And now if you go to other developing countries, you go to say India, you go to China, you go to Vietnam, you go to Thailand, you will see minimum wage policy is in place. But if you look at the level of minimum wage in the developing countries, you'll be shocked by looking at that level. But at least there are
minimum.
It's the bottom line of wage that you are not allowed to legally fall below the market. But the problem is that the level is low, the compliance is very low, and so. And to move to the more global standard about the labor rights, in 1928, minimum wage was adopted as the international conventions by the International Labor Organizations. So this is even before the declarations of the human rights. You know, when was the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted?
1948,
after the Second World War. The history of minimum wage was much earlier than the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Probably the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was also inspired by this kind of things. And fit into the economic rights, socio-economic rights component of the Universal Declaration. Probably, I don't know. So, initially, we can put a kind of proposition saying that the adoptions, triumph of minimum wage, can be seen as the product of modern civilizations. You must understand the life of the workers during the Industrial Revolution. Yeah? There are movies, stories. So that's why you have the one who own the capital, they are powerful, and you have the owner of the manpower, the workers. They are poor, they are powerless. So they just receive the subsistence wage that will keep them alive, not die. So that's subsistence wage. Minimum wage is far higher than the subsistence wage. This is minimum wage is sufficient to meet the variety of needs of a person living in a civilized community. But during the Industrial Revolutions, the level of wage in the UK or in Western Europe was only at the level of subsistence wage. Subsistence wage, the wage is just enough by food to keep you alive, and then you go back to work. Yeah. So the okay, this is the data. Of course, I'm biased in providing the picture. I put Australia at the top. Just to show you, yeah? Of course, there are countries that have a minimum wage a little bit higher than Australia. Belgium, Luxembourg, they have a little bit higher minimum wage also, but not major country. But look at here. All big countries there, major countries, all of them are the members of the OECD, the group of rich countries. They have the level of minimum wage far lower than Australia. Even the US, this is the US. This is Spain. This is Korea. Okay? New Zealand, France. This is UK. This is the UK. So this has been adjusted to the different price between countries. So this is based on the constant US dollar in purchasing power pair. So they are compared. So you understand now, Australia is one of the countries in the world with the highest minimum wage. Okay, is there any questions about minimum wage now? Now it should be yes.
From that conclusion, it kind of shows, indicates that, like you said, maybe minimum wage is not necessarily good for economic growth, because we have seen this country, you know, US, you know, they did so well a certain time of history, but now, because it's almost like it's not going to be sustainable, when the market is completely free, you know, it might generate a lot of money, a lot of economy, but in the long run, which Australia actually is looking good in terms of world economy. Because that shows maybe that minimum wage actually is good for long-term economic growth, but not necessarily short-term.
So what do you think? In the long run, do you think that... Of course, this is not about having higher minimum wages or goods. It's not the question. The question now is, to what extent? This is not the economic judgment. Minimum wage is a kind of the outcome of the struggle. What you can understand from this perspective is the advocate for the minimum wage in Australia is much stronger than the advocate for the minimum wage in other countries. One. Or the second one is the power who are against the rising minimum wage in other countries are stronger than the power of who are against the minimum wage in Australia. So there are two ways to see this one. Yeah? One is, in Australia, the one who advocate the minimum wage have stronger power than the same advocate in the US, the UK, Spain, whatever. That's one explanation. Second one is, the power that try to keep the minimum wage not to increase is stronger in other countries than in Australia. Probably that one would be this is the outcome of the bargain, not necessarily economic decisions. This is a kind of battle, if you can, of the proponent and the opponent of the minimum wage. But this is the reality, if you see Australia in a comparative perspective. Let's move now to the unemployment benefits. What is that? Okay, simple questions. Have you enjoyed? Have you benefited from receiving unemployment benefits so far? Have you? Is any of you?
Yeah.
Okay. Again. So what is the, if you are the firm believer in the free market, there will be a gains on the market. Because if you are unemployed, that's your business. Work hard, invest, find more jobs. Okay? Why someone will have to pay for you? Yeah? The money that you receive when you are unemployed is the money of someone else who pays tax. So why someone will have to be bothered to help you when you are out of jobs, for example? So if you are the true believer of the free market, you don't like the idea of unemployment. But now the question is, why a country should put a policy to provide help, safety net for those of you who are unemployed? What was the idea of providing that kind of safety net?
Can I speak again?
Yes, no problem.
Okay. A lot earlier, I was saying that about the also I mentioned economy. It's not that it's an economic issue, but the issue here is that, yes, if you're a true believer of the market, then unemployment benefit is good, right? Because you're not looking long term. Because what happens if something happens? What happens if the market is totally free, there's no safety net for the vulnerable ones?
Yeah.
So what happens if for some reason, you know, natural disaster, whatever, something happens, what are you gonna do? You know, people start in the streets, and then this, so that's what I'm saying. So therefore the employer benefit is actually good for long term economic growth. Because just in case if something happened to somebody, you know, then we can support you to bring you back on track.
But unemployment benefit is not designed for the long term. This is just to help you when you are fall at a certain level, to help you to bounce back.
But that's what I'm saying. I'm saying that to bring you back on track, so it's good for the general, for everybody.
You are too kind to think about that. Okay. But from the more short-term, more humanistic perspective, this is the right armor. You will not let fellow human being within your country, within your society, to fall below certain level. That would be the responsibility of the other society. So the argument, the first argument was the right reason. Then you can put that argument. Then you put more economic argument. Let me tell you more economic arguments. If you have massive unemployment, and there is no the provisions of unemployment benefits, what you can think of? Crime rate will increase.
Yeah.
Chaos. Anything. Then, who will pay the cost of the money? The one who have the property. The one who have asset. The one who have business. So, in the economic term, in the long run, it will be good for them to share some of the tax that they pay to share to help the unemployed. Then, we have the stability. So but the economic argument usually comes later. Okay, once you realize that at the starting point you don't realize the kind of benefit. But to start with, the idea of unemployment benefit is more on the rights, more on the willingness, the idea of helping the powerless, the unfortunate. But you can't be unfortunate for the rest of your life. Yes. That can be a problem. So that's unemployment benefit. So this is a form of social security. Okay. Of course, there are many unemployment benefit can be abused. Yeah. Rather than working and then just a little bit above the poverty line, and then why not rely on unemployment benefit, and then your life is not much different from working. So there are issues here related to the abusive part of the unemployment benefit. But the basic idea is very, very noble. So this is a form of social security or social safety net, but there are other kinds of social safety net available in the society in Australia. So unemployment benefits are the social welfare payments made by the state to the unemployed people. That's the unemployment benefit. So two things are important in the context of unemployment benefit in Australia. First one is according to your age, the new start allowance or youth allowance. So I'm sure that you are now above 16 years old, so you can be entitled to one of each, or probably both. Yeah? So now, again, let's go back to the basic questions. If you are unemployed for whatever reason, why you should receive them?
It's a whole day like other people, because you do not have any income coming in, and the government would be held accountable for whatever would be a responsibility of their tax. The people that would you wouldn't be able to leave the property, get a house, and the street would be full of homeless.
So the idea is very normal. You don't let the fellow human being fall below a certain level. You look at the amount of money that you receive from the unemployment benefits. That would be probably not will save you above the poverty line, but at least will not make you too far from the poverty. Or the unemployment benefit will not make your life so miserable, too far from the level of minimum wage. So you can see the roughly close relations between the income from minimum wage, the poverty line, and the income that you will get relying on the unemployment benefit. So this is safety net. Minimum wage is safety net. Unemployment benefit is a kind of safety. The idea is not to let fellow human being below, to fall below a certain line. So you set that line. What is a decent line? So you decide. The society decides. So Australia as a country have the standard, have the idea of where that line is being set. Now the next question is, who pay for that one? It is good that you receive unemployment benefit, but you should ask also, who pay for it?
Taxpayers.
I have never received minimum wage in Australia. since I arrived here 9 years ago. Now the amount of money that I pay in my tax every year keep increasing. So I am one of the contributors. If in case you receive an employment benefit in the next 1 year or 2 years, once you graduated from the university with a bachelor degree, you have no job and you go to something later because you are unemployed. And you can. So be mindful of that. One of my lecturers paid tax for the whole of his time in Australia. So you have to understand that the minimum, the unemployment benefit that you receive is the money of someone else. So they will not like the unemployment benefit is being abused. They will not like the idea. But they will not reject the idea of unemployment benefit is good for the society. So this is that you need to understand. So taxpayer money is the taxpayer is the one to pay. And then, so what is the basic idea of minimum wage? This is a kind of, if you, Reading Relief and Development is not part of this unit, but the idea is like this. If, for whatever reason, some of you to be unlucky to be unemployed, and you are helped by the unemployment benefit, so the unemployment benefit is designed to be temporary, to provide some relief in the difficult situations, hopefully with the relief that you can bounce back. So you prepare yourself, you deal with that one, and then you rejoin the labor force, you keep improving your skill, keep climbing the level of wage you receive, and then you are, at the end of the day, the contributor to the less fortunate unemployed people in the society. So in the future, if you are unlucky again, you can be the recipient of that one, but everyone should try to get move out as possible from the unfortunate situation. So the idea was a temporary help to the unfortunate unemployed people. Yeah. So that's the basic idea. Who pay? The one who fortunate enough to earn and to pay more. So that's why you have we have different rate of taxations. If you have high income, you keep rising your income, you pay more percentage of tax from your income. If your income is low, you don't have to pay tax. You get subsidy. So that's the mechanism to have to create a good society. Otherwise, can you imagine? If you are unfortunate enough to be unemployed, no one is helping you. If you are fortunate enough to generate profit, to receive, to enjoy high wage, you are contributing. So what kind of society that you will have? You will have massive inequality. Okay?
Crime,
instability. So that's why you will see the long-term economic and social benefit of having those two things, the social sacrifice. I think I explained this one, why we need to the unemployment benefit and who pay, and this is from the taxpayer money, mainly through the progressive taxation system. Now, you have to link the minimum wage and unemployment benefits. Yeah? Those two things are very closely related. So, which one should be higher? The income from the minimum wage or the income from the unemployment benefit? Which one should be higher? Not to create
minimum wage.
What happens if the unemployment benefit is higher than the minimum wage?
The budget is okay.
So you need to set the minimum wage needs to be higher than the unemployment benefit. What about they are just roughly the same?
Still budget.
You agree? So you need to understand the behavior of people to design the effective policy. So you cannot set the minimum wage less than the benefit of minimum of unemployment benefit that you will receive if you are unemployed. So you are not allowed to be too generous in terms of the unemployment benefits. So the problem, the discussions now in Australia is not about to have or not to have an unemployment benefit. The discussions now is to what extent the benefit of unemployment benefit can be gained, but the abusive part of unemployment benefit should be minimized. So the idea now is to set the right balance, not to have or not to have. This is not the discussions. So you have to be mindful about the generosity of unemployment benefit, because that one will be related for not to jeopardize the incentive of people to join the labor force and to get paid employment. So be mindful of the generosity of unemployment benefits. And then you need to understand also the cost for the taxpayer money. If you set it too high and then so many people are abusing the unemployment benefits, I am the one who at the other end of the equations, I am the one who are contributing to the funds for the unemployment benefit, I'll be very critical about the government policy. And you have the way to voice your concern. Okay? This is not right. Unemployment benefit is too generous. You can see that many people are abusing the one, so the policy is something wrong with the policy. So you criticize the government to set the policy. Okay, that's about unemployment benefits. Trust off between the generosity of unemployment benefit, and you can see that how should we set the unemployment benefit and the minimum wage. Okay, the third thing, human rights. I don't have to explain what is human rights. You are now in week 11 of the semester. You know more than me about human rights. So I'm not going to talk more about this one. Let's link now human rights and minimum wage. So, do you have any idea how to link? The easiest way to go is to read the main reference of human rights provision, the Universal Declaration. So now, let's read the certain articles in the Human Rights Declaration. So, I just typed it for you. Article 22. Read it carefully and then you will see the human rights basis of minimum wage and unemployment benefit. Everyone, as a member of society, has the right to social security and is entitled to realization through national effort and international cooperation and in accordance with the organizations and resources of each state, of the economic, social, and cultural rights indispensable for his dignity and the free development of his personality. This Universal Declaration. Your ability to implement depends on the ability of the country, of the state, of the society. From that perspective, you can see that Australia is in the advanced situations of implementing this kind of principle. In the next article, you will see that one. Point one, in Article 23, everyone has the right to work, to free choice of employment, to just and favorable conditions of work, and to protections against unemployment. So basically, Article 22, 23, 24 is about socio-economic rights. Are part of the second component of the human rights. If you think human rights can be divided into two, civil and political rights, and the provisions of unemployment benefit and minimum wage are part of the second component of the human rights, the economic, social, and cultural rights. Okay, now, let's try to link development progress and the policy on minimum wage and unemployment benefit. So remember that those two things, unemployment benefit and minimum wage, are the outcome of modern. provides a country higher your level of civilizations, that will move together with the policy of minimum wage and unemployment benefit. So you can see the kind of policy, the social, economic, and cultural rights of the people are the functions of the progress of every society. So if Australia has reached a good level of minimum wage and unemployment benefit, it means that Australia has reached the development progress that allows them to implement that kind of policy. So easy to see the other side of the equations. What about the country that hasn't reached development progress as advanced as Australia? Easy to imagine. They will have a very low level, very poor implementations of minimum wage policy. They will have very minimum provisions of unemployment benefit, or none at all, for example. So now you don't have to go far. Look at countries around Australia. Look at Fiji. Yeah? In the Pacific countries. Look at Indonesia, East Timor, Thailand, Philippines. And ask them, yeah? If you are unemployed, what kind of support that you can get from the government? And you will be surprised to know the answer. Ask them, are you protected by the minimum wage? What is the level of compliance? Or if they comply, what is the level of the minimum wage? You'll be surprised to know. So you need to know country beyond Australia to understand the advance that we enjoy in Australia. So this is just to link the development progress and the two policies, minimum wage and unemployment benefit. The first point, Australia is at the top positions of the countries in the world with regard to minimum wage and unemployment benefit policy. Yeah. If you go to the US, if you are out of a job, you are on your own. I don't know how kind of misery that we will have to be unemployed in the US, but I'm sure that if you are unemployed, it will be way better here in Australia than in the US. I know that. And then Australia is a welfare state. And the degree of the welfare state in Australia is better than the US, and even the UK, yes. Way better, but probably less than Scandinavian countries. But from that perspective, we can see that the content of welfare state component in Australia is among the top. Australia is the welfare state. Australia is a developed and rich country with mature and advanced democratic system. Why I'm bringing the idea of democratic system? Because the advance of provisions of minimum wage and unemployment benefit is the outcome of political struggle. So you need to understand the divide between the Liberal Conservative Party and the Labour Party. You must understand that the minimum wage and unemployment benefit are the key policies advocated by the Labour government. Yeah. So you need to understand, you need to go back to the history of divisions between the class division between the capitalist and the worker. Then the worker will have to defend the rights and they have to organize themselves, and the peak of the struggle was to have a party. That's why you have Labour Party in the UK, you have Labour Party in Australia, and you have Labour Party in most of other European countries. So this is one side of the equation. So you have to be able to link this kind of struggle to the struggle of the less powerful, disorganized group initially. And then, the third propositions, minimum wage and unemployment benefits are the outcomes of development progress in a country. So you are not rich because of you have good minimum wage or good unemployment benefit, but they are the outcome of becoming rich country, becoming advanced country. So if you want to be rich, so if you think of a poor country, you start to increase minimum wage unreasonably, and you start to have the provisions of unemployment benefits, but you are a poor country, you can't afford them. So you don't start with that one, but you start with good economy, and then you can.
Yeah, but it has always been the case, isn't it? Because to say that, you know, for the country to be able to be well off, the cake needs to be bigger. And obviously, we have seen the developing country, it hasn't been the case. The cake will get bigger, but the inequality is also growing. So people, some people taking, you know, everything else. So I think there's more things they need to come to.
So that's why this is not about, this is not easy to set the line. So this is about the struggle. So of course, level of inequality in the developing world are higher than in the developed world. That's true, generally speaking. But don't forget, inequality in the developed world now are rising. Yeah. So
I think the issue with social welfare is tax, and that's one of the current policy debates in Australia. The wealthiest people in Australia are not paying as much taxes, for example, you and I, and the people even poorer than us. And this is a huge problem with respect to supporting our welfare systems. And I think that's kind of, I feel like that's just missing a little bit, that tax.
But basically, the progressive is there, but the question is how progressive is that one. Yeah. The second one is tax avoidance. If you are at the higher end of the income, you have more opportunities to hide your tax. And you have more political privilege, influence, to influence the policy, not imposing higher tax on you. So you need to refer to the Panama Papers. And how many hundred Australians are on the list. So that's why in politics, I mean, your comment, we have to touch the basic setting of politics in the developed world. We have only a simple idea. The politics of the common people, the one who advocate the interests of the common people, the lower end of the income distributions, and the policy that will advocate the preference of the people in the higher end of income distributions. Then you have the liberal and labor divide. If you go to other, most of Western European countries, you will see that we have Labour and Conservative in the UK, we have Social Democrat and Conservative in Germany, you have Labour also in most of Scandinavian countries, you have Democrats and Republicans in the US. So the setting is about who will advocate the lower income groups, and who will advocate the higher income groups. So you can see the divide. So the problem now is, the problem now in the developed world, the rich of the rich are becoming even more powerful. That's the problem. And then we have discussions about the middle income people like us, we pay more relative to our income, compared to the, say for example, the one who earn 3 million a year, for example, 2 million a year, for example. So proportionally, the burden of the middle class is heavier. So this is where the, probably the unwanted directions of policy in Syria that we want to see change. Yeah? That is not preferable for having a strong welfare policy, because that's the source of funding to source of money to finance the welfare policy. And the last one, this is again back to the title. Minimum wage policy and unemployment benefits are the product of civilizations. It is not granted, it is achieved. You achieve the class through better, through public awareness, through political battle. Okay, so back to the key point of the lecture, please don't take it for granted. This is the outcome of long process, philosophically and politically. And the basic setting of politics in the developed world is about defending the rights of the, say, the bottom 60-70% and the interest of the top, say, 10%. Oh, now it's not 10%, top 1%.
Even worse,
yeah? But the idea is, if you have the income spectrum from the lowest to the highest, you have different political preferences. And this political setting is exactly accommodating those preferences. And you battle. Yeah? You battle in every election. Okay, this is more about reflections. This is about reflections. I'll end this lecture in the next 5 minutes, by the way. So, and then we can have discussions after that if you want more discussions. So, some reflections. So, Universal Declaration of Human Rights is a manifesto, but inspired by the observations of the life of human being around the world. So, it's a manifesto in the idea. And you can see that if you go to poor countries, Sub-Saharan Africa, you read the Declaration of Human Rights, it's nonsense. It's no way to see in reality. It's just an idea, but it's good to have the idea. So, the conceptions of human rights is basically about the human concept. Remember that the Declaration was adopted after the Second World War, not even after the First World War. So one of the ideas of adopting that one, to create more peaceful world. So can you link human rights and peace here? The fulfillment of human rights are key to peaceful society. That's what we need to understand. So the misery of the First World War, the Second World War have inspired the adoptions of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So human rights conceptions is as a product of human civilizations. So it means that after being non-civilized, to have the First World War, Second World War, and the series of war in Europe before the First World War, human beings in the world have become more civilized. And then, but at the same time, you still have war, violent conflict, atrocities, exploitation, discriminations, all those things. But when you are, you reach the level of civilizations, when adopting the Universal Declarations, but you travel around the world, you still see those things. So one of the key explanations was because of the human rights, either the political rights, the or economic rights. So fulfillment of human rights in every society or in a particular society is key to have peaceful society. So they are related. Human rights and peace are related. I'm just trying to link the discussions to the name of the unit, human rights, peace, and development. So, I told you before that a country or a society, they will be able to implement the economic and social rights because of the progress of development. When the progress in the development, they can fulfill the economic and social rights, and then they will move towards peaceful society. So you can see the opposite. If you are not that developed, you are not that able to fulfill the human rights conditions, and you can see that kind of society, that kind of country is not that peaceful. And you know that Australia is a peaceful country. Okay? You can protest. If you don't like something, you can say open. Can you do that one in another country? Even in Malaysia, in Singapore, or far here. Can say a bad thing about your practice or your actions. You'll be arrested. But here you can say anything about your practice. No one will arrest you. It's fulfillment of the right to express what you think. Yeah? So that's the outcome of the political development. Okay, some reflections. So the state of human rights fulfillment and peace are subject to the level of development. So they are related to human rights. Peace and development, they are related. They are moving together. So what is development? You need to understand now development not only from the income perspective. You need to understand development from multidimensional perspective. Economic development, social development, political development. From the political development is about to what extent a country adopts a quality democracy. That is the most important dimensions of political democracy. Probably the most important dimensions of political democracy. There are many measures if you want to see the economic and social development. But from political development, you can use democracy as the key parameter. Now, you can see that the currently developed countries have gone through periods of human rights violations and war, conflict in their own history. Just look at Australia. You think that Australia now is a good country, having a very good provisions of social and economic rights, and your rights are protected. If you read the history, the short history of Australia compared to the US and Western Europe or other parts of the world, or China, for example, or the Middle East. The history of Australia is only in the past 200 years or 150 years. Not long ago, you see human rights violations. Certain people will not receive their rights. You see the gangster in Australia are there indeed. So you need to look at a film that show the life in Australia just 50 years ago, 70 years. Gangster everywhere indeed. So you reach the level of high level of civilizations, respecting the human rights, but after experiencing the gross violations of human rights. So can you understand now the violations of human rights in countries at the lower level of government? Probably that the cost that we have to pay to reach good level of human rights provisions. Probably, I don't know. Okay, this is a bit more, this is Deborah's request to put this slide. To link socio-economic rights, conflict, and crime. Okay, just to have a bit more discussions. So if you think of conflict, civil war, for example, we are not talking about Australia. Australia is, you don't have civil war in Australia. We don't have horizontal conflict or bloody conflict, ethnic conflict in Australia. Australia is a very peaceful country. But if you think of violent conflict, civil war, in most cases they are linked to poverty. They are linked to stagnant economy. They are linked to unemployment and underemployment. And the absence of social protections. Lack of education. Inequality between groups, for example. And then, In conclusions, violent conflict, civil war are related to the deprivations or lack of development. So when you have deprivations and lack of development, you will see the very poor provisions of human rights commitment or fulfillment, if you like. And then, what are the mechanisms for war or violent conflict to happen? Given the situations of deprivations and lack of development, three things can be mentioned. One is you have the genuine grievances of the poor, the unemployed, the unprotected, the exploited, whatever, may have genuine grievances. Then you have conflict, or you commit crime. Second one is, if you are with the situations of deprivations and lack of development from a multidimensional perspective, the opportunity cost for you to engage in violence is very low. Here, for you, you are young, you have the power to engage in violence, you have the capacity, but the opportunity cost for you to involve in the government is high. You have much more to lose. But in poor countries, like in sub-Saharan Africa, you have pool of young men. They are unemployed, they are hungry, they are poor. What is the cost for them to engage in violence? Close to zero. Yeah? So that's one mechanism to understand why civil war or violent conflict is more likely to see in the situations of deprivations and lack of development. The third mechanism. The deprivations and lack of development create opportunity for the conflict entrepreneurs to try their entrepreneurships in using violence for economic and political gain. So if you think of warlord in any of the conflict-prone sub-Saharan Africa, you can see this kind of region. At one point in time, you know, you remember Laurent Kabila, the father of the Joseph Kabila?
Yeah,
remember that one? He said, at one point in time, he said, launching war in Africa is easy going on. What you need is $10,000 and a satellite phone. With the $10,000, he said that I can hire a small army. Because people are so poor, with few dollars you can recruit, you can develop your own army. Here, $10,000 you can do. Nothing you can do with $10,000. Then what you need, what is the use of the satellite phone? To make a deal with the foreign buyers when you use the army to exploit the diamond field or the natural resources or the mining or whatever. So war is a business. The outcome of the business or the entrepreneurship of the conflict term. One factor, one variable situations that enable them to do that one because of the availability of the recruits. Yeah? So you see the perfect coincidence. You have the conflict interpreter and you have the availability of young, poor, male, unemployed, without future, ready to participate, ready to be recruited as your own. So you'll find that kind of situations in most of, in many of conflict-prone sub-Saharan Africa. So roughly speaking, if you think about crime, that would be similar. For the crime dimensions, easy to imagine situation in Australia. In Australia, in what kind of suburb that we think crime rate is high? What kind of suburb? Poor suburb. That's why you don't want to live in poor suburb. You want to move to a better off suburb. In the poor suburb, you have high crime because the opportunity cost to engage in crime is low. They are unemployed, they are poor, they are with low level of education. So you combine different things: unemployment, drug abuse, crime, low education, low skill, whatever. So for crime, you can see things in Australia related to that kind of framework. Civil war, violent conflicts, probably not applicable to us. So that's why I put the crime there to not to see things too far from us. So, where does Australia stand in our discussions about human rights, unemployment benefits, and minimum wage, or in overall about socio-economic rights, the fulfillment of socio-economic rights? Where does Australia stand? You know that. You know that, yeah? So that's all. So this is not the topic, this is for you to answer, and you know that. So I hope that you will not take for granted those two kinds of goals, minimum wage and money.
But for the last question, can we say that on the top, relatively? Can you say that? Like relatively to other OECD countries?
Of course. So can you name other countries who are, roughly speaking, in better positions than Australia? What are those countries?
Canada.
I'm not sure about Canada. Australia is better than Canada.
You're actually looking at countries like Sweden and
Norway.
Scandinavia. Scandinavian countries are generally better than Australia. But you are less likely to move there because Scandinavian countries are too poor. So you have to choose, like progressively, rather than living in Norway or in Finland, okay? It's not nice there, very cool, okay? So that's why, you know the asylum seekers? Australia is one of the favorite places for the asylum seekers to come. Because they know that Australia is nice.
Yeah,
okay.
Most of them are coming here now.
Yeah, why not?
And a lot of us are not coming here.
See? So that's the cost for Australia to be a good country.
Yeah.
So you have to understand the
question. My question was that it's true, it's on top, but that goes down to the minus island issues. I mean, when you are locked down in minus island, you want really fair asylum seeker, you want to say that it's actually a good thing. But my point was, yes, definitely Australia is good, but it's relatively so. There's still work to be done in Australia, even though.
I agree with that. Of course, this is a very broad overview to see how Australia should be fairly compared to other countries. But if you want to examine the problem with the Australian's fulfillment of social and economic rights, the problem with Australia in that kind of is, of course, you will find different issues. The Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island people, the treatment of asylum seeker in Manus Island and in Nauru, of course.
But you need to understand that all the politics,
they keep showing that 800 people in Manus Island, 2,000 in Nauru, they keep the one as they're showing deterrence effect. They didn't want to abandon them. Look, you come here, you see this one. So the current government is having interest in keeping them alive. To show the one who are planning to come, look, if you come, then you will. So they use it, I know that.
Part of the policy. The government's also facing a little bit of dilemma now because the Papua New Guinea government ruled that is unconstitutional. So
according to Australia now is trying to influence the Papua New Guinea parliament to revise the constitution.
We tried to send police in about a decade ago and they were kicked out as unconstitutional.
Okay.
As well.
This is not a big problem. Just appeared in the news 2 days ago, I guess. Okay, so of course, if you want to look Australia deep into the within Australia, of course, you'll find problems. But my point here is to help you to fairly compare Australia vis-a-vis other countries in the world. To what extent Australia is better, to what extent Australia is way more advanced, but of course, this is not to deny the problem of human rights fulfillment within Australia, of course. So, other more questions. I hope you enjoy the one, and I hope that open your perspective on what the social economic rights component of the human rights. Okay, if there's no questions, thank you.